our final event of our celebration, our annual celebration of Banned Books Week. Banned Books Week actually ended last week, but here at the Nahman-Watson Library at DCC, we never want to end a celebration too early, so we're extending it to today. So today is our final event of Banned Books Week. What is Banned Books Week? Well, since 1982, librarians and bookstores have gotten together, and it's an awareness raising campaign. It's a celebration of individuals' right to read and individuals' right to learn. And these rights are protected under the First Amendment of our Constitution. And a student asked us last week as we were getting things together for our display, like, does this actually still happen? Do books still get banned and challenged? When in actuality, just a month ago, a school system in North Carolina voted to take Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man off the shelves. So students in a community in North Carolina just a few weeks ago now no longer have access to this book. So it's something that I think is very important and timely, and something we still need to keep raising awareness of. In addition to celebrating freedom, the freedom to read, we also celebrate the freedom of the press and just freedom of information in general. A strong democracy really depends on a well-informed population. And it definitely seems like in the news very recently, there's been many stories that have been going on that have dealt with freedom of information and challenges to freedom of information, freedom of the press. I mean, individuals are going on trial very, very publicly, very nationally for sharing information. And popular magazines are being boycotted because of their choice of images that they would use. So it's issues that are still very as prominent now as ever, and it's not always easy to stand up to speak out on behalf of the First Amendment. And when we were discussing how we were going to plan our events for Banned Books Week, we just couldn't help but keep coming back to someone over and over again who we felt has as much bravery and as much integrity as anyone in standing up for freedom of speech. And that person was Edward R. Murrow. For those of you who might not be as familiar with Mr. Murrow's story, he was a broadcast journalist at CBS. He first became famous for his on-the-scene reports in Europe in the days leading up to World War II and during World War II itself. He became basically the most well-known and well-respected broadcast journalist in the United States. In fact, he's still an icon to this day. In 1996, TV Guide put out their list of the 50 most important and influential people in the history of television. Edward R. Murrow came in number 22. So that's pretty significant. He's probably most well-known now and most famous now for the work that he did after World War II, during a time in our country's history known as the Red Scare. I could elaborate on his work during that time and the really significant things that he did that changed history, but I think I'm going to leave that up to our speaker today, because he'll do a far better job than I would. And we're overjoyed. We couldn't be happier to be joined by this person today, who probably could provide as much firsthand account of Edward R. Murrow as anyone in the world. He's also very highly regarded professional in the education field. He's a wonderful speaker. I think you're really going to enjoy listening to him today. So it's an honor and a pleasure for me to introduce to you the son of Edward R. Murrow, Mr. Casey Murrow.
Thank you all. And we'll begin with a few little clips from various places and a few slides that might be useful to you. But my main point in putting this talk together was to think about your Banned Books Week and the idea that there were so many ways to approach freedom of the press. Which, of course, is not just the printed press, certainly not anymore, nor is it just books. So there's a lot to think about in the whole realm of controlling what other people are allowed to see, think, or do. I think the whole topic that Greenfield Community College has been working on in the past week is really exciting in that regard. And I hope we can talk about it a little bit more when we get to some questions, and I'm happy to be interrupted at any time, by the way, so if you do have questions, let me know. We'll see if this particular piece of audio is even intelligible to you.
This is Trafalgar Square. The noise that you hear at the moment is the sound of the air raid siren. I'm standing here just on the steps of St. Martin's in the Fields. A searchlight just burst into action off in the distance. One single beam sweeping the sky above me now. People are walking along quite quietly. We're just at the entrance of an air raid shelter here, and I must move this cable over just a bit so people can walk in. I can see just straight away in front of me Lord Nelson on top of that big column. There's another searchlight just square behind Nelson's statue. Here comes one of those big red buses around the corner. Double-deckers they are. Just a few lights on the top deck. In this blackness, it looks very much like a ship that's passing in the night, and you just see the portholes. There goes another bus. More searchlights come into action. You see them reach straight up into the sky, and occasionally they catch a cloud and seem to splash on the bottom of it. I'll just ooze down in the darkness here along these steps and see if I can pick up the sound of people's feet as they walk along. One of the strangest sounds one can hear in London these days, or rather these dark nights, just the sound of footsteps walking along the street, like ghosts shod with steel shoes.
So my dad's work was, as Eric said, began as a broadcaster. He began as a broadcaster during the Second World War. That is, the Second World War as it started in Europe, not the United States' engagement with the war, which didn't come until after Pearl Harbor. So he was broadcasting for 3 or 4 years from war-torn Europe before we really entered the war. So it's important to remember that his work, it's important for me to remember anyway, that his work began in radio. And the work that he did in television came much later. And one of the reasons that his work in documentaries in television, including the McCarthy documentaries, was so successful was that he had a tremendous amount of recognition from the public already because of his work in radio. He continued his work in radio. He happened to think that was a wonderful medium and one that he really wanted to stay focused on, but television became the place where he was better known. So radio from the United States, radio from Europe, was a very questionable process, certainly during the Second World War. Radio coming from Europe was often interrupted. It was short-wave transmissions in many cases and was hard to hear. But there were a tremendous number of incredibly competent people who provided word from Europe about what the process of the war was like. When I was thinking about this last night, it occurred to me that we often think of how important it is now for reporters to present both sides of any story. The American reporters who reported on the Second World War did not present the German side or the Japanese side to any great degree. They were very clearly on one side. Just an interesting phenomenon of the way people talk about things now versus the way we did at that time. He moved from radio to television. This is obviously a somewhat faked press photograph of a studio, but he began to do a series on CBS television called See It Now, which was a documentary that ran for an hour and then later for half an hour on a schedule that allowed them to do a fair amount of production work for the various programs. That meant that the programs, which are mostly shot in 35 millimeter film, amazingly, were very carefully edited and allowed them to do things like the McCarthy broadcast, which took the better part of 2 years to put together, the two broadcasts. As you can see, it was what we would now think of as primitive equipment. If we look back at Gary there, he's got all the equipment just right there on that tripod that's probably was in that studio. It's amazing what can be done now, but the stuff that was done then, if you go back and look at documentaries from the 50s and 60s is astonishing because they didn't have the editing capabilities that people have now and the possibilities that they have. There's Senator McCarthy. You saw a quick shot of him in the little bit of video that we showed at the beginning with Walter Cronkite introducing a program, which is actually a fascinating program and has on it all of the two See It Now McCarthy broadcasts. If you ever want to watch them, they're available in multiple ways, but they are quite fascinating to watch, partly because they're so long and they go into so much detail. And their choice was to use the senator's own words to essentially critique his work. And that's why it took so long to put it together, because they had to get bits of film from various events, and then they described the events and put the story together in the documentary. A very lengthy process, and one that wouldn't be very easy to pull off today. Some documentary work continues to take that kind of time, but not a great deal of it. So Senator McCarthy was certainly an incredibly powerful figure, and one who was able to elicit very strong reactions from his supporters, so that in opposing him, for anyone to oppose him, was a huge risk. And that was true not just for my dad, but for everybody who worked on these programs with him. It was helped a little bit by the fact that they did have some delay in putting the programs together, and that other criticisms of McCarthy were coming out, but not very many. On the day that this first broadcast, this is actually a picture of the senator in a broadcast that he made in response. The day that the See It Now program came out, Senator Ralph Flanders, who was a senator from Vermont, senior senator from Vermont at that time, spoke on the Senate floor and denounced McCarthy. And that was the first time anybody had really spoken out about McCarthy in the Senate, which was his home base, basically. So Flanders' speech, which is kind of neat to look at if you want to at some point, he was very, very clear about what he felt McCarthy had done to the country. And by basically incriminating people without any substantial proof, often with no proof at all. And you saw a picture, if you watched that very beginning, of a woman named Annie Lee Moss, who was a clerk in the Army Department, and who probably was picked up by McCarthy's people by mistake, because there were four other women in Washington named Annie Lee Moss, and they really made a mess of their investigation of her. The McCarthy folks did, and that made it quite easy to do a television program that made them look a bit ridiculous for what they'd done. So there were opportunities to do work that showed McCarthy operating in ways that certainly weren't part of what our Bill of Rights calls for. And he had, at the same time, a degree of influence that allowed him to get on the air and get in newspapers to a phenomenal degree. So opposing McCarthy was a risk on television, it was a risk in print, and it was certainly a risk even in the Congress. So eventually people began to come around to disagreeing with him. We do have a person who can confirm some of this, by the way, because Kim Gregory in the front row here worked with my dad at CBS. So you can check out a few of these things with him at some point. I thought you might be amused to see the headline from the New York Post later on, when President Eisenhower decided that he too didn't like what McCarthy was doing. And I've used this in a couple of high school classes, and I said to Mr. and Mrs. Gregory that the problem was not knowing who Murrow was, but knowing who Ike was in some of the high school classes. And this actually has another interesting clue, because McCarthy then went on to say that we were delaying our development of the hydrogen bomb because there were too many communists in the government, in the U.S. government, and we were somehow helping the Russians out by doing that. And he got a little carried away with some of his pitches, which made it easier for people to critique him. My dad's critique of him came at a time when some of his friends who were more conservative said, "How could you do that? How could you do a program like that about McCarthy?" While some of his more liberal friends said, "How could you possibly wait so long?" So there were many people who hoped that this kind of program had been done a year and a half or 2 years earlier, when McCarthy was most vicious in some of his attacks on people. On the other hand, it happened when it happened, and it happened with tremendous effect, even though, and I always find this fascinating, we think of television, well, maybe we don't think of television as being very important anymore because it's disappearing with lots of other media possibilities. But when it was most important, it was everywhere, right? People with three televisions in their house, with cable, with all sorts of ways to access it. But when this program, these series of programs, anything from the 50s came out, it was reaching an urban audience, cities basically around the country. If television was available in rural settings, it was one channel, or maybe a couple of channels, and poor reception. So the number of people who actually saw the McCarthy programs or anything else at that time, even though had a terrific Nielsen rating for viewership, but in fact, very few people saw it around the country. Some of the impact was felt in the press commentary that came later. So the value of sort of going from what television was depicting, was talking about, to what the press could say in print in the many, many newspapers that were available. At that point, when we were talking earlier, 7 or 8 still in New York City, right? Of daily newspapers. So what the phenomenon of the daily newspaper had a tremendous impact in the reach of television. Of course, once you missed a show like this, you missed it, because there were kinescopes, so-called, which was a way of recording them, but it didn't come back on television, and there were no reruns, and there was certainly no TiVo, and all those interesting opportunities that have come since then. So McCarthy was a person that my father was deeply concerned about in terms of the way he was presenting himself to the country and the damage he was doing to the country. But my dad was equally interested in people who were doing other sorts of things in the country, and See It Now continued after the McCarthy broadcasts. Those are often seen as sort of the high point of that program. They continued with many, many other wonderful documentaries, including a series on Carl Sandburg. This is down in North Carolina, Sandburg walking through his property and talking at length about his poetry and about his beliefs in America and so forth. So Sandburg and others on the much more liberal side got a voice, a different kind of voice, on this kind of documentary program as well. I put this in, and by the way, I'll explain while this background is here with this I believe up in the corner in just a moment. I put this slide in because it comes from the Atlantic magazine in 2012. And it's a story about a program, the last documentary that my dad did, called Harvest of Shame. He went to work in the Kennedy administration after this particular program was done. Harvest of Shame depicts, it's also a fascinating one to watch, depicts migrant labor in mostly in Florida. It was done in the end of 1959 and early 1960. It was filmed at that time. It was broadcast on Thanksgiving Day, 1960. So we're all sitting down to a nice Thanksgiving dinner, and what comes on the television but a documentary about the people who raised the food that some people were serving, and raised it in squalid conditions, living in squalid conditions, no support for them beyond an incredibly small rate of pay, terrible working conditions, and so on. And what interested me about this, which is a story about Cesar Chavez, is that it also mentions Harvest of Shame, a 1960 documentary with the article written in 2012 saying that basically a lot of things haven't changed for migrant labor in many parts of this country, let alone elsewhere. So that struck me as an example of my dad's work and the work of many other people to produce a program like Harvest of Shame at the end of his broadcasting career that still rings true to a lot of people. Harvest of Shame is available on YouTube and a number of other ways that you could watch it for free. It's quite a remarkable program. My dad did some other programs too. He never gave up on radio, so he did a nightly news program. Quite how he did that, maybe Kim Gregory can explain to us how that's possible, but somehow he did a nightly program on the radio for 15 minutes. It was a world news kind of program. He did See It Now on a regular basis, and he did this weekly series called Person to Person. This is an ad for it, really. And I put it there partly because I thought the television set was evocative of that era and the kind of sets people were looking at, but also because it really was a form of entertainment show. Their idea was to do two interviews in each show. One was to be a prominent person who would we'd all recognize, and the other would be with somebody we wouldn't recognize, but who was an important, in somebody's eyes, an important person in a community or the world or whatnot. Every time they did the famous person, the ratings went up. Every time they did the person who was less well known or not known at all, the ratings went down. So of course there was a lot of pressure to stick with the famous people, and that was really the beginning of a lot of television entertainment that lives on interviews with well-known people. See It Now was the beginning of a series of documentaries that went on, still go on television and elsewhere. And one of the early producers on See It Now was Don Hewitt, who went on to develop CBS Reports and other programs for CBS. Quite fascinating connections all the way through. Now, this is, I left all these screens just as I had them. Well, no, I changed a few, I guess. But I left them mostly as I had them for a group of students at Jacksonville University in Florida. They read a book of essays called This I Believe that my dad had put together, along with several other people, as a radio program through the early 1950s. It ran for 5 years, from 1950 to 1955. And they were essays by prominent and not so prominent people about their personal beliefs, not their religious beliefs, really, but their beliefs about themselves and the world around them. And the Jacksonville students had not only read the book, but they'd begun to write essays of their own. And they did that by following guidelines that this organization, This I Believe, which exists now and continues to produce thousands of essays by students, by adults, by people of all stripes. If you look at thisibelieve.org, you'll find some absolutely fascinating personal essays that are done from the 1950s or done from 2013 and everything in between. My dad had a belief statement. It was really part of his introduction to the program when they first started it. It was at one point the most famous, the most widely listened to program on radio. It was also the most widely circulated in print in newspapers. And the first year they brought out a book of essays, the only book that sold more copies in the United States than that, than this, I believe, was the Bible. So it really is quite a remarkable piece of work that went on top of all sorts of other things. So in his efforts to communicate with people and to educate, because he thought that radio and television was really a process, or could be a process of education in its best light, he ran afoul of corporate America to some degree. He ran afoul of CBS management at times, and decided to go at the invitation of President Kennedy to become director of the U.S. Information Agency, which was at that time, it's now part of the State Department, but it was an independent agency at that time, producing the Voice of America and many, many other programs and magazines all around the world, much more so than it does now. He was able in doing that to rehire three people who McCarthy had forced out of the State Department, and Dad was able to hire them back. So there were a lot of things that went full circle in his quite short life, because he died at the age of 57. And he was particularly proud, I think, of his broadcast work that did support the Bill of Rights and and of course, especially the First Amendment. The First Amendment is now visible on Pennsylvania Avenue. If you've been to Washington recently and gone to the Newseum, that is N-E-W, Newseum, it's really a fantastic spot to visit. And on their wall, the outside wall of the museum, is the First Amendment cut in stone on the wall of the building. Inside are a vast number of really fascinating exhibits, including one about my dad, but many about press freedom and the concerns of people in many parts of the world about press freedom, because you know that we have vastly more freedom of press in the United States than most other countries, that far too many journalists get killed every year doing what they do as reporters and writers. And killed would be the worst situation, but oppressed, jailed, and whatnot would fit in there too. So I think my dad felt very strongly about the work he did he would have said to some small degree, supported the thinking that made this country, as far as he was concerned, great, important, and valuable in the history of the rest of the world. So I'd love to answer questions if you'd like, but I'll wrap it up right there. Yes.
No, please don't. I'm here with four other civil liberties scholars here.
Great.
And I'm particularly interested in your dad's work today, and the government is shut down. When I saw the picture of Senator McCarthy, I couldn't help but see another current senator. The tension is that branch of government, of which Senator McCarthy was a member of a different chamber, nevertheless a member, he, in furtherance of his ideology, and from what I've read, and I love Fred Fenley's book about your dad and his list, but in furtherance of the ideological meanings of his constituents, we have a senator today and other people in the House of Representatives today who are willing to shut down the government on the basis of their beliefs of the evil that's being done upon us. And I can't help but see the analogies between Senator McCarthy's paranoia about communism and what we are seeing today. And I'm just wondering about the role of the press. And I'm wondering about today's media in the context of the way that saw his obligation and what you just talked about in terms of balance and voice.
And added to that, I think today is the phenomenon of so many sources of news. We can certainly find examples of wonderful reporting about what's going on today in Washington. But we can also find lots of examples of, I forgot that I have a lavalier mic on, but it doesn't have any impact on this particular sound system. So the multiple ways that we can get news is both valuable and a problem, isn't it? Because we can get locked into our own, my favorite thing. If I like the Huffington Post and I only read the Huffington Post, I am getting a slanted point of view. Maybe I like the slant, but it is slanted. And so I need to look elsewhere I think we all do need to look elsewhere if we're going to find a variety of points of view. But it is true that Senator McCarthy's tactics might parallel some that are going on today, though I think he had an easier job in a way than some of the representatives and senators who are arguing about this at present. He had one issue. He was a one-issue guy for a long time. He had identified communism as a huge threat. It was a concern. There certainly were things that were happening in the world that made communism a concern. And there he was. He was set to go. Today, with a lot of the issues that we're dealing with, there are multiple points of view, and there are shades of gray to a degree that might not have been quite so true in the McCarthy era. The struggle with what the press reports and how quickly they report it and who they report on, though, is just as fascinating today as it was then. What about the ease with which a congressman from a small district in California can get on the television and the radio in one day to talk about his point of view about the Affordable Care Act. It is fascinating that some people seem to gain access in ways that aren't open to all, or at least aren't obviously open to all. But I don't think that really answers the question, because I think it's an ongoing debate. Whatever our media outlets are now are obviously changing at such a rate, too, that who knows what we'll be reading or listening to or looking at within 5 years or 10 years. Will a certain set of voices narrow that down and become predominant, either in what we might think of as a good way or a bad way, or will the whole world open up to even more voices? If you follow enough things on Twitter, you can sure get a lot of voices. How much they mean or how much value they have, that is a fascinating question.
I have two questions. I had hoped to hear about your father's involvement in what I don't know a lot about, which is the Red Scare. And also, I wanted to ask if there was any relationship between the Bob Dylan song, where he's talking about looking for those goddamn Reds everywhere, you know, the one?
He was certainly talking about the same kind of stuff, for sure. So was Woody Guthrie in a bunch of songs that Dylan, of course, picked up on, too. So when you mentioned the Red Scare, we've had a bunch of Red Scares. We had one right after the First World War, and then we had, McCarthy was certainly, that whole era was a Red Scare era. So from when, 48, 49, people were already talking about the dangers of communism, and then right up to the middle of the 50s, some people would probably say longer than that. Even Senator John F. Kennedy, then President Kennedy, had to be extremely careful about communist threat, and you only have to look at the Cuban Missile Crisis to see that as a phenomenon. And why did we stay at war in Vietnam? I mean, that was a domino theory. That was the idea that if we didn't stop them there, they would show up in California or Hawaii or whatnot, which is a kind of incredible idea when you think that the Vietnam War was really a civil war. But we can leave that for the moment. That's a little too confusing to get into. Anybody else?
What your dad was working on at the end of his life, if there's something that did not come to fruition, that he had sort of a large picture of, or did someone else pick up on work that he had come to?
The thing that he was, I mentioned that he had trouble. Can everybody hear me okay if I don't use the mic back there? Is that all right? He had trouble with corporate America in terms of broadcasting. He loved the idea of the BBC in England, except that he didn't think it should have quite as much government control as it had then. It's beginning to lose some of that government control. Maybe that's great now. So he thought that an independent public television or radio service would be terrific. And he was involved in some very early meetings that resulted in the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and NPR, he was extremely interested in that work. But that was before any of that had surfaced, so it was talk at that point of, you know, could we do this? Could someone figure out a way to fund it, bring it to some form of fruition? So that, I bet, would have been where he might have headed had he lived longer. So he smoked cigarettes. He smoked way too many cigarettes. Don't smoke cigarettes.
They all did.
They all did, yeah, yeah. And if you've seen the film Good Night and Good Luck, which is about the McCarthy era, two things that you might be interested in, picking up on the cigarette smoking, they had to smoke a lot to do that film. And there's a kind of fake cigarette, is it cinnamon or what is it? Cloves, a clove cigarette. Smells horrible. And so some of them smoked that, and some of them went back to smoking, which some of those actors had done when they were younger. And so they had a terrible time. And even shooting it, there was always smoke in the room, which was correct. That's the way it had been. They did phenomenal research on that film. And I give George Clooney and his gang tremendous credit for the way they researched that up to the first day of shooting. When I was there on the first day of shooting, they were still checking out things with Joe Wershpa and others to see if they had the story right. So that was impressive. The other thing that I thought might be interesting to tell you about that film is that they auditioned several actors to play McCarthy, and they had some really good people. But every time they tried to do it, they thought, people are going to say we're just completely framing this guy, because in order to play McCarthy, you had to sort of giggle the way he did and seem a little bit odd at times. So they realized they had to just use McCarthy for McCarthy. So they used the original film, as you can see in the film, they used the original film from the program to depict McCarthy, and didn't use an actor. So those decisions are fascinating. If when someone's trying to create a movie now that was meant to have popular appeal, and yet was meant to tell a story that was as accurate as it could be, they fudged some timelines in places, but they didn't really just to make a story out of it. But they didn't change much of anything else. Anybody else?
Your father's reporting. How do you distinguish between his duty to deliver facts and his duty to explain them?
Yeah, isn't that fascinating? I suspect he developed that partly in Europe during the Second World War, because he had to. They certainly had to get the story right. They were also censored sometimes, so they had to be careful about what they could actually say anyhow. He did have the luxury of, all reporters at that time, had the luxury of several hours or even a day or so to file a story, whether they're filing it in print or audio, radio. they didn't always have that luxury, but a lot of times they did. So when he wrote his piece about being at Buchenwald, the concentration camp, that he went in with the first American units to get there. And so he saw exactly what the camp was like. And he was so horrified by what he'd seen that it took him 2 days to write the broadcast to find some level of balance, because he realized he had to tell what he saw accurately and find a way at the same time to express a bit of opinion about what he saw. He also did that in his radio broadcast. Maybe that's the reason he kept on doing the radio broadcast, that nightly 15 minutes was 10 minutes of news and 3 minutes roughly of commentary. So he would do a commentary piece at the end, which obviously was editorial. It was intended to be editorial. So finding that balance was, it's incredibly tricky for everyone, I think. Whether it's my father 50 years ago or somebody this afternoon trying to write a story about something that's going on today.
Your father took on some sort of sacred cow and took on the corporate, he had this way of speaking truth to power, right? But within the system of broadcasting, it came across very straight-laced kind of thing. So he died what, in around 65. What was his feeling about the counterculture, the growing nascent counterculture? Any feelings about that, like the beatniks? So that's, did he identify with any of that sort of counterculture in that he had some of those, some of those desires to take down some of these big...
Yeah. I was 19 when he died. I wasn't a very good example of counterculture. Some of my friends and I were sort of idiots at times, but we didn't have an organized counterculture that we were part of. So I think that he probably didn't delve into it as much as he might have. He would have seen more of it in the 50s, I think. Yeah, he didn't do any programs on Kerouac or any of the beat poets or whatnot, so in that sense, I don't know.
They did have a shared agenda on something.
Yes, he did. Yeah.
His voice is very, very important, because you're coming from that point of view, you can really make an impact on the way Life magazine did.
Right. And I suspect that. To the degree that he had a link, an interest, or whatnot, there, I might not have known about it, because it would have been when I was a fairly little kid. So the McCarthy stuff, for instance, was done when I was 7 and 8. So I knew something weird was going on, but I didn't know what exactly.
Yeah, I looked at a lot of the material that's on the Tufts archive online, which, if anybody's interested, that's very fascinating. I was really fascinated with your mother. She was kind of like the woman behind the man kind of thing, and I wondered if you could talk a little bit about their time in World War II in London, because it seemed like she wrote some of his radio programs or helped write some of his radio programs. She had kind of a little quasi-career herself, and they seemed very... during that time frame.
Yeah, I think they were, and they edited each other's stuff sometimes too. She broadcast for the BBC quite a bit, so she really did have a broadcast career during the war, until I arrived, basically. She is a fascinating study. No one's written a book about her, but if any of you would like to, there's a great opportunity, because she was one of a very small number of American women who stayed in London all during the Second World War, with the exception of one trip back to the States. She was an active participant in a number of major events in England during the war. One of them was a project called Bundles for Britain, which was, before we entered the war, we were neutral. We didn't, except we weren't really neutral, but we were sort of neutral. And we would send things like an occasional aircraft or ships that we could manage to release to the British. But we also sent lots and lots of just stuff, kids' clothes, all sorts of materials that were in, because the British needed everything. There was nothing they didn't need. So there was, it wasn't just food, it was everything that, that one could possibly help with. So Bundles for Britain was literally any of us packing something up, packing up some used clothes that you've got, send them to New York. They got, it's somewhat like containers today. They got packed in on huge pallets and shipped in ships that, of course, were subject to being torpedoed to England. And Mom was very active in that. She was the British chairman of that whole operation. She was also very involved in something you may have heard about there was recently an NPR program about this, about kids from England being sent to the States and to Canada during the war to get them out of the war. And she did that for a couple of years and then resigned from doing that because she felt it wasn't the right thing to be doing. That there were plenty of places for the kids to be in England, and why split families up to that degree? It was a well-intentioned effort that probably didn't quite work the way people planned. So she had a bunch of endeavors like that in addition to the broadcasting work for the BBC. She became a more typical 50s mom when I showed up. And she did a lot of volunteer work and things like that in New York, but she didn't return to being employed until she had graduated from Mount Holyoke College, and she went back to Mount Holyoke as the director of the art collection after my dad died. So she had another career at that point. Thanks for asking. She was a very remarkable person. Janet Murrow, Janet Brewster Murrow, and a tie to Greenfield is that her dad grew up in Worthington, Mass, one of a hill town, not very far from here, and her grandmother, in her later years, wintered in Greenfield. I love this idea. She didn't go to Florida. Nobody went to Florida then, so. She had an apartment over near the park, Poets Seat, right, or the tower, and
Beaconfield, Poets Seat.
Oh, Highland.
Poets Seat, yeah.
Okay, was it Island Park?
Yeah. I don't know.
If it was a small park, it was a pretty section in there.
Well, and Mom showed me the building once, but I don't think I could pick it out anymore. At any rate, so the family on my mother's side had strong ties to this part of Massachusetts. So I haven't made much progress. I live in Putney, Vermont, so I've just gotten upriver a little bit. Joanne came from there too, passed through. Yes.
I'm Chris Shores from the Greenfield Reporter.
Great.
Can you talk about what you think your dad would think about
I'm always a little bit leery of that question because what would my father think about media today? I can't ask him, so we have to do some guesswork. But I think he was fascinated, although he would say he was not a techie person. He was fascinated with technological change and the things that they could do on radio and television, which in the 50s were amazing. In the 60s were amazing for that time. And so I think he would have been fascinated with our ability to communicate in a variety of ways and to share information as quickly as we can. He would also certainly have been worried about our ability to spew out information too fast, and to confuse people or misrepresent things because of that. But I think overall, because he, you know, He was born in 1908, so he'd be a pretty old guy if he was still around. But he probably would be interested in the kind of camera work that's possible today, and the kinds of communication that's possible, and the ability of so many people to talk to one another. If you look, we have a middle school daughter right now. She has a friend whose parents are teaching in Kazakhstan. These two girls communicate regularly with both video and audio from Kazakhstan to Putney, Vermont. That is such, and I'm sure others of you have had similar experiences, but it is a phenomenal thing to watch, that people of their own volition can communicate over those distances and share ideas. There are stories that say that there were only two American reporters, and you're thinking about the Second World War.
Yes.
There are only two reporters in London who weren't censored. One was the NBC correspondent, and one was my dad. That's not true. It's absolutely not true. They were all censored. And if you were doing the broadcast, the censor sitting across the table from you with his finger on a button, and you just start one word that he doesn't like, and it's over. So the challenge for them was to write stories that were acceptable to the British censors, because they were in England. They didn't get American censors, they got British censors, that didn't compromise the war effort in some way. But the stuff I know that got censored were individual references to things, not whole stories.
Like names?
Yeah, names, places, anything that would give away something. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the censors are much more sensitive than anybody else, so they would see problems that others wouldn't see. But censorship was certainly a part of the Second World War in a big way. Isn't that fascinating? Yeah. I think... and it's not just Snowden, because there are other people who've done this in a variety of ways. I think he would be most surprised that Snowden left the country, that he went to Hong Kong, and then to China, and then to Russia. It's a little bit confusing. I realize that Snowden wants to maintain his ability to release material, and that's why I assume that's why he did that. But it is a little bit odd that he didn't sort of stick to his guns here in the States. I think that's what my dad might have wondered about. The phenomenon of releasing material, he was a reporter. He went out looking for stories. He went out looking for things that that the rest of us didn't know about, and that were at times embarrassing to people and upsetting. I think the level of sort of mutual respect in areas like the military in the 1950s would have kept him or anyone else from doing what Snowden did, maybe. But then you look at the release of the Pentagon Papers, for example, in the 1970s, mostly about Vietnam, pretty fascinating stuff. We've had whistleblowers like that on many occasions. We haven't had someone releasing as much data. The other thing, when you say, what would my dad have thought of that, he would have thought it was remarkable if someone showed him one document and said, look what I found. The idea that someone could show you 300,000 documents would have just astounded any reporter at that era, I think. So I don't know. Anyone else? Should we call it quits? Sure, go for it.
What do you do?
What do I do? I work with schools in a number of states, but mostly in Vermont right now, around professional development for teachers. So improving classroom work in, I particularly focus on math and science, but I also work with people who work across all sorts of curriculum areas. And a lot of us are working right now on the Common Core and that whole idea of a more common curriculum. Some people in this room probably took the MCAS. So we're looking at what will happen with Smarter Balance and some of these other efforts to create assessment that's fair and not punitive. That's what I hope we're getting towards. Assessment that will support change and improvement on the student's part and not be just a gotcha kind of test. So I love doing that. I've been a classroom teacher and I worked in schools for years and years. I think of it as sort of like my parents' interests because both my parents were interested in education. I didn't think that through when I was in my 20s, let's say, but it does seem to be sort of a tie with their interests, not what they did specifically, but their interests.
What did you think of David's portrayal of your father?
David Strathairn's in Good Night and Good Luck? I thought it was fantastic. I thought he captured my dad's voice remarkably well. And there's a thing in the movie world called a read-through, where the cast comes together for the first time and they sit in, you know, tables like this, just around a square, and they read the script. And many times the cast, they haven't seen each other before either. It's really, the whole thing's a brand new idea. We're going to sit down and read the script. And I was there, and I sat on a table over here, and he was reading where you are. And they did the whole thing. It takes a long time because you've got to read you don't just read the script as in what you say, but you're also reading the blocking and the directions as to, you know, who's supposed to be where and what's happening now and so forth. And so we went through the whole thing, and I went around the table afterwards and I said, I thought you were so great. I thought you really got my dad's voice in such a clear way. And he said, oh my God, I was terrified. He said, because there were three of us sitting on the other side, all of whom knew my dad. And he said, I had to read in front of you. And said that was awful. So, but he's a terrific actor. And if you've seen him in other things, I think he does a wonderful job. So I was thrilled he did that. Should we call it, as they say in the movie business, a wrap?
Yeah, it was good night and good luck.
I should say good night and good luck, yeah. I don't know who's got the copy or the copyright on that now, but anyway, we should find out. Eric, thank you so much. This has really been fun to do.